The properties of an infinite impulse response filter is expressed in the relation h of z, which is the transfer function, b0 plus b1z to the power minus 1 plus so and so till the n term bnz to the power minus n, divided by the polynomial 1 plus a1z to the power minus 1 plus so and so till the term m, where we have amz to the power minus m. So this polynomial can be represented using summation in the form summation of bk times z to the power minus k, where k changes from 0 to n, divided by 1 plus summation ak z to the power minus k, where k here changes from 1 to m. Here, ak and bk are the filter coefficients. So, choosing the filter coefficients is a choose of the transfer function, which is also the choose of how this filter act, whether it is low pass or high pass or any other type of filter. The transfer function can be factorized to give h of z equal to k, where k here is called sensitivity and gain, times z minus z1, times z minus z2, and so on, divided by z minus b1, multiplied by z minus b2, and so on, which is equal y of z and x of z. Here, z1, z2 until zn is the zeros, which are the roots to the numerator, as we said yesterday, while b1, b2, and bn until bn is the bools, and it's also the root of the denominator terms. The choice of z, z1 and until zn and b1 until bn represent how this filter act. The coefficient k is usually used to represent two constants of the instrument. One is the sensitivity, which represents the sensitivity of the sensor. So we have geophone, or we have seismometer in general. This seismometer has sensitivity, which means it contains a sort of amplification to the ground vibration. So this means the sensor can be sensitive to a certain amount of ground vibration. This like factorization or like amplifier. The other term, which is called the gain, is related to the recording or the system itself, which is also used to amplify ground vibration. And as you know, ground vibration are so small that if we are not going to use such amplification and sensitivity term, it will be difficult to identify. Okay, this relation, is retyped here, the same relation. And in order to define or determine the values for the coefficient, we have to use the relation for the difference equation for the filter, which is written in the form y y of n equals summation from 0 to infinity. H of k, which is the transfer function of the filter, times x of n minus k, which can be written in the form summation from k equals 0 to n, bk x of n minus k, minus summation from k equal 1 to m, ak y of n minus k. In relation to FIR filters, the only advantage of the IIR filter is that it uses low memory than the FIR filter. We have many disadvantages. First, they are more susceptible to problems of finite length arithmetic, such as noise generated by calculations and limit cycles. We discussed this yesterday. If we if it happens that our computer or our calculator has less digits than it is needed, so we have an error in the output signal. The problem is that this output signal is then feedback or returned to the filter and added to the new input signal. So I'm introducing error into the filter and summing this error, which may result at the end with bad behavior, distorting the waveform or so. They are harder, meaning slower to implement using fixed point arithmetics. And finally, they don't offer the computational advantages of FIR filters for multi-rate, which means decimation and interpolation applications. Decimations, like if I am trying to downsampling the time series I have, like suppose I am having a sample rate of 100 samples per second, and I want to reduce this to 50 samples per second. So this is a kind of a decimation. And approximation is to find the, interpolation is to find the value of the amplitude between any two successive points. You have, I guess, idea about interpolation from other classes. So these two interpolation results in oversampling or making the sample rate higher, moving from 100 samples per second maybe to 200 samples per second. So we put more sample point in between the original samples. According to our discussion yesterday, when I asked you about what is the type of filter we see, I felt that we need to see this diagram. This represents the types of filters, the common types of filters. The first one is the low pass filter. From the figure, it is evident that the lower frequency are passed without any reduction, and then the higher frequency is reduced and totally removed after certain value of frequency. The other one is the high pass. It's evident that the lower frequency is removed or reduced in amplitude, and then the higher frequency is allowed to pass. The third one is the bandpass filter, where we are looking for certain band of frequencies. We need to look at certain band of frequency. So before and after this frequency, this two corner frequency, the amplitude is reduced or removed. The final one is the band reject, you know, which means that low frequency is allowed to pass, high frequency is also allowed to pass, but there is certain band we want to remove from our data. We may use such a diagram for matching question. You may have in a question in the final exam or even in the quiz we are going to have. You are going two columns, one with this diagram, and the other with the low pass, high pass, band pass, and the band reject. Then you match. You know, you match, you connect, maybe you may connect from the terminology to the proper curve. Of course, in this case, this word will not be present. So that you have the graphs and you decide which is suitable for what. Now, we go to our issue, or the main issue of this class, which is the main seismic processing sequence. This picture or this diagram show the situation where we are collecting. Here, this car represents the source and the recording instrument, and we have this is the cable and geophone, and then the energy is sent into the ground, interact with the interfaces, reflected, then returned back to the surface. What you see in the corner, in the far corner of the block, is a well. In our general practice, in order to have good interpretation of our seismic data and the moving or converting time into depth and converting reflectors into lithology, we must tie with a well log. So this well there represents the tying between our work and the well logs. So well logs is represent as the, we may say, the absolute truth, and we are transferring our data with this absolute truth or absolute knowledge about the subsurface. One may ask, so if we well logs would help, so why we use seismic and other geophysical team tools? Because well logging is very expensive, and I cannot cover all the area of exploration with wells. It will cost a lot, and it will be high effort. So seismic and other geophysical tools give me the mean to reduce cost and to get more detailed information and view about the subsurface. So what are the basic processing sequence? Before we are going to discuss this point, we review what we have said at the beginning of this course about why seismic data processing is applied. Seismic data processing is applied in order to enhance signal to noise ratio, in order to represent seismic data in a way useful for interpretation. So, seismic data processing is a vital and important step. It can either result in good interpretation or bad or very bad interpretation. So, as we said earlier, that seismic data processing and interpretation are working in recursive or in feedback system. So there is modeling and then comments and then remodeling and then comments until we reach to the best representation or the best viewed seismic section. So our main or basic processing sequence are sorting of seismic data. In this part, we are shooting multiple times, and our geophones are moved multiple times according to this shoot. So, how to sort our data from sources, from shots, and from receiver, and how this will be used for further analysis, like the normal move out and velocity analysis. You know, in common practice, there is an offset between the shot and the receiver. Okay? Then, the ray path between the shot reflector and the receiver are slant. It's not normal. Slant because both shot and receiver are not on the same location. If the shot and the receiver are in the same location, then we have normal incidence and the normal reflection. You have seen this, I think, if you have studied GPR. You study GPR?
Yes.
So, GPR is nearly normal incidence and the normal reflection. So we can regard GPR as normal moving from source to receiver and backward. Sorry, from source reflector and backward to receiver. But in our case, we cannot put both the shot and geophone at the same point, so there is offset between them. Offset means distance between the shot and the geophone. And then the motion, the ray, move in a slant direction or slant path like this. Okay, here is the shot and here is the receiver. In normal move out and the velocity analysis, we are trying to correct for this slant path to vertical one, to imitate that we are shooting at this point and we are also collecting or recording at the same point. So in this step called normal move out, we are moving out the effect of the slant path of the ray, of the seismic ray, to remove the effect of the slant, which means to remove the difference in time. You have to get information about velocity. So a normal move out, we do also velocity analysis in order to obtain the velocity for the reflector and to determine delta T, which is the difference between any two shot geophone record from the same point to correct, so that we are nearly shooting from and shooting and recording from the same point on the surface. After this, we are going to stack traces we got. Stacking means summing, to sum traces. So after applying normal move out, we have multiple traces coming from the same point in the subsurface and corrected for this land movement, all are corrected for this, and all represent moving from the source perpendicularly to the reflector, and then recorded perpendicularly or vertically by the geophone. So we assume that all the reflectors from the same point at the same after normal move out coming at the same time. So by summing or stacking these traces, the energy belonging to the useful or reflection energy is enhanced, because the energy is coherent, they are coming, they will be in phase. While noise in this case will be out of phase, because of course they have different velocity, and then applying delta T will, if not canceling each other, they will keep their amplitude, then the signal to noise ratio in this case is enhanced or increased. Then we move to zero offset migration, which is the final step in the basic seismic data processing, which means that to return the point in the subsurface to its original place. I guess if we remember, for giving interface as an example, if this is the source and this is the receiver, we are expecting that the energy or the midpoint will be here. So collecting the trace from this bear, I am assuming it will be here, but it's not the case, because due to the dipping, the original point will be this one. So in migration, I am working to remove this point or return this point, migrate this point from this virtual place to its original one. Okay? We have also extended processing. This extended processing are data formats. You know, there is a lot of data formats. At the earlier time, every company worked on its own and made the special format. Then, after some time, there is a meeting and convention, and there is a demand to you need to standardize these formats, and then we came with SEG format, SEGY format, and SEGD format. So one of the objectives is to reformat our data, come from the recording instrument to a standard one. This is very important for data handling and data exchange between companies and between bodies. For example, I don't know the exact name here in Malaysia, but the authority for petroleum exploration here, governmental body, I don't know the name yet, when it wants to get some information from a company, and this information is needed for decision making, so the company must provide the data in a format that can be used by the, for example, the governmental body. Also, if I'm working in a project, I want to submit my data or sell my data, so this data must be in a standard format. If you are not using a standard format, so your data might be useless. Then we have to deeply look into surveying information and field geometry. This is a very important issue. You have to know the exact location of the shots, You have to know the exact location of the receiver, and you have to identify difference in elevation. You have to identify azimuth and so on. All these parameters must be introduced into a CGY file for later use. Because if it's not entered in this step and it's lost, your data also will contain error, and this error will affect the output of your work. Then, is there any question? Then we move into trace editing and balancing. You know that the seismic energy that travel less or shorter distance will have higher amplitude, while the seismic signals that travel long distance will have small amplitude. So in this step, we are editing, we are checking that we have data. Sometimes your cable is malfunctioning, where there is problem, there is noise. So first you examine the quality of your record, you have no noise, we have actual data, and then you work on the amplitude balancing, meaning that you want to make all energy coming from both near to far distances have a balanced representation on your trace. Then we apply static correction. The static correction, we have two parts. The first one is that the geophone in the ideal field will not be at the same elevation. So for static correction, we will correct first for the difference in elevation. Then we start by choosing reference surface, where all the difference in time between this reference surface and the amplitude at the surface is identified and removed. The other type of static correction is a weathering correction. You know, the weathered zone at the upper part of the surface of the Earth have much lower seismic velocity than the deeper or the bedrock. Then at the weathering interface, we expect to have high impedance difference, which result in high reflected energy. This high reflected energy masks the other energy coming from deeper interfaces. So one of our objectives is to remove the effect of this weathered zone. We usually do so by defining this weathered zone using seismic refraction tool. Then we move into deconvolution, either to remove the effect of source widening, either to enhance, to spike, and so on, as we said earlier in this course, in the part of deconvolution. And then we move into filtering in the FKX domain. The FK domain represents the spectrum of the time series and the spectrum of the space distribution of geophones. So, as we said earlier, we have the transform of time into frequency, and transform is into of space into k or wave number. In FK domain, we can define clearly the ground role. Ground role is the type of surface wave that travel along the surface of the Earth, and it has also high amplitude and also affect the record, and it is one of our objectives to remove ground rot. This among other applications of the filtering in the FK domain. Then we apply deep move out, DMO, breeze tag, partial migration. And this is very important even before applying the normal move out, because if we apply normal move out, assuming we have horizontal interface, we'll end up with error in locating this point. So it's important to apply DMO and to be sure that the point, the common midpoint we have is in the same and is in its original place. Then we use zero offset post stack migration algorithm. Then we are converting from time to depth using all information like the velocity analysis, like sonic logs, like check shots. All these tools are used to define the velocities, and these velocities then used to convert from time to depth, or in other words, to convert from seismic section into geologic section. We have to keep in our mind that our objective is not to produce good seismic section, but our objective is to produce good geologic section. So this is very important to keep in your mind. And then we it's not the actual distribution. This breeze stack migration is also done with the deep move out migration, also to avoid a change in the, so breeze stack means before stacking point in the basic seismic processing sequence. Post stack means applied after the seismic, the basic seismic, after stacking in the basic seismic processing sequence. Now we will start by basic processing. We choose to use sorting, to start with sorting of seismic data. This, of course, is the first point. It represents how we're going to see our data collecting from the field. We have two main categories here. We have common midpoint gather, and we have common offset gathers. This diagram represents the common data acquisition in the field, either for land or for marine. Okay? Now, for illustration, we are going to see this. This is shot number one. It's not necessary that this are offset in laterally. This are offset laterally to identify what's going on, but this is on the same line. So we start by shooting at this location, and the geophone will be there, recording. And then we move certain amount, usually one geophone interval or 0.5 geophone interval, according to our desired coverage. This will be discussed later in land and the marine acquisition. And then we shoot again, and then we move certain amount, and then we shoot again. These marks represent the midpoints. And this, for example, this midpoint between the shot and the first geophone. The other midpoint between the shot and the second geophone. The third between the shot and the third, and the fourth is the same. So as we move the midpoint is changed, which is the spatial location on the surface. But if you have a look here, you will see that these two points are occur twice, and also this point occur twice. Okay? Of course, we are making this maybe for 48 times offset, 96 times offset, and so on. So, suppose this is a common midpoint. If you can imagine this one, this one is the midpoint, one of the midpoint in the subsurface, because there is a number of midpoints here. And we have this one is a short geophone bear here. This, we call this, for example, for this point, we have short geophone pair for this midpoint. Thus, here, all, for certain midpoints in the subsurface, all this represent short geophone pairs. So, if I'm using, say, 48 offset, then I'm expecting to have 48 short geophone pair for the same point in the subsurface. Okay? They change in what? They change in the offset. Okay? The offset between each pair is increasing or decreasing if you are taking from here. So in this direction the offset increase, or from here it will decrease. So I am looking to get for certain point the to get the normal move out, or normal incidence and the normal reflection. So this diagram or this curve in the right hand represent the common midpoint for certain point in the subsurface. We have here, say, 24 fold, representing the reflectors we have. This is one, and this is another reflectors we have. Of course, this is not true acquired data. It's synthetic, because in the true, we have other types of energy like refraction and so on. That will, of course, affect our record. Then, this one is a common offset gather, which is either common shot gather. I have one shot. I have one shot, and I'm gathering all data coming from this shot. So this is called shot gather measurements, and this is a diagram representing the gathering. These are the traces for the number of points in the subsurface. This diagram is meant to define for us the difference between the common midpoint and the short point or the short gather. Here, all the traces I am collecting belongs to the same point in the subsurface, in the common midpoint. While in the short flat or the short gather, I'm having the common here is the short, and the traces belongs to multi points in the subsurface. The zero offset gather, this is applied such that both shots and receiver are at the same location, which means we have normal incidence and normal refraction. This is how our section looks like. This diagram represent the relation between the number of gather we are speaking about. The horizontal axis represent the axis of the source, the location of the source, while the vertical represent the geophones. So if I'm taking gathering vertically, it will be, this is map view. This is not a cross section. This is map view. I am looking at the map. Okay? So if I'm collecting and perpendicular to the XS axis, I'm making shot gather. So I'm collecting data for single shot. If I use collect to collect from one receiver, so this is called common receiver gather. If I am using for certain point in the subsurface, so it will be perpendicular to the trend of geophones, it will be common midpoint gather, and this one, which is taken for certain geophone for various stations, for various shots, is called common offset gather. All these gathers have application in our work, and most importantly for this point, we are going to focus on common midpoint gather. It will be used by next week lecture for normal move out and velocity analysis. I used this reference for today's lecture, and this is a link. You can download the book and use it if you like. Okay? Thank you.